I'm Jamie Thompson, and I'm a first-year medical student in the medical education track. To start my presentation, I want to walk you through a clinical scenario. So let's all fast forward 1 year from now, which means that all of us that are currently first-year medical students are going to be third-year medical students. And let's imagine that we're all in our internal medicine clerkship. So one day, we're at the hospital, and we're asked to go evaluate a new patient. You walk into that patient's room, and you see this. What comes to mind? If you're me, maybe you think any number of these questions. Uh-oh, that looks pretty scary. What is it? Why does my patient have it? And now that I'm responsible for taking care of this patient, what do I need to know about it? What do I do? How do I take care of it? Hopefully my talk tonight will answer all these questions for you. If you don't know, that was a tracheostomy. So tonight I'm going to be talking about tracheostomy basics for medical students. My goal is not for you to become experts in everything related to tracheostomies or even really know everything about them. I want to provide you with some information and a brief overview about tracheostomies so that if or really when you encounter your first patient who does have a tracheostomy, you won't freak out and you'll know what to do in case of any complications or emergencies. The outline for my talk tonight, first I'll be talking about what a tracheostomy is and why a patient might have one. I'll go briefly over some basics of tracheostomy care, and then I really want to get into some potential complications that your patients with tracheostomies may run into and what you should do about them. So by definition, a tracheostomy is an opening in the trachea created through an incision in the anterior neck. This is done to provide an alternative airway for the patient who is unable to ventilate through their mouth. It's located midway between the sternal notch and the cricoid cartilage. And there are many different ways and procedures done to place tracheostomies. I'm not really going to go into the details of that. There are a few different components of the tracheostomy that you should be aware of. So this is the tracheostomy. This tube is what's going to be sticking out from the patient's neck that you can see. It's connected to a hollow tube that goes into the airway that's called the outer cannula. And then a separate tube, known as the inner cannula, is kind of placed nestled inside the outer cannula that also goes into the airway. Inside the airway, there's a cuff surrounding the outer cannula. This can be inflated or deinflated, and that when inflated, it would completely block your airway so that the only air that can pass into the trachea is coming from the outside through your cannula. So what are some reasons that one of your patients might have a tracheostomy? Can you think of any? One is ventilator dependence. So if your patient requires mechanical ventilation, and that's expected to be needed for a long period of time, up to 2 weeks or longer, you might place a tracheostomy. This can be done for ease of care, and taking tracheostomies can be cared for more easily, or it could be for the comfort of the patient. Alternatively, there could be some problem or obstruction in your patient's airway. This can be caused by a lot of different factors. I have a few listed here, angioedema, burns, multiple failed intubations through the mouth, perhaps some sort of mass or malignancy in the patient's airway. Another reason is pulmonary toilet. So the patient has too many secretions and can't handle them and continues to aspirate. One important distinction that I want to bring to your attention is between these two patients. So on the left, this patient has what we call a patent upper airway, which means that their airway from their mouth through their pharynx, larynx, and into their trachea is all continuous. Now, obviously, they required a tracheostomy to be placed, so there's probably some problem with their upper airway, so it's not completely clear or patent. But nonetheless, these airways are all continuous. In contrast, this patient on the right has undergone a procedure called a laryngectomy, which is the complete removal of the larynx with separation of the airway from the mouth, nose, and esophagus. So this patient, their upper airway through the mouth is no longer continuous with the trachea. Instead, the trachea is only continuous with the stoma, otherwise known as the opening of the tracheostomy. So what is the significance of this distinction? Why am I bringing it up? Why do you need to know about this? The answer is that your patient who's had a laryngectomy, they're only able to ventilate through the stoma because their trachea is not continuous with their natural upper airway through their mouth. In contrast, the patient on the left here who has not undergone a laryngectomy, their trachea is still continuous with their upper airway, which means they have two possible airways and two possible sources of ventilation, through the stoma and the tracheostomy, or through their natural airway through the mouth. This is really important to keep in mind with your patients, you want to know whether or not they're completely dependent upon their tracheostomy for ventilation or if there is this alternative upper airway through the mouth. Remember also that, like we said, patients who require tracheostomy, they may not have perfect upper airways. There might be some problem with it. But these patients that have undergone laryngectomy, that's not an option at all. Their upper airway is not even continuous with their trachea. So briefly, some information about tracheostomy care. Fortunately, most of this is done by nursing staff. So the details of it are a little beyond the scope of this talk. But in general, tracheostomies require suctioning, cleaning of the inner cannula, regular assessment of the airway patency, and surgical site maintenance and cleaning. So now, what I really want to talk about are potential complications of tracheostomies. So let's say that you are, you know, you meet this patient with a tracheostomy, everything's going good with them, taking care of them, but what are some potential complications or things that might arise that you might need to know about? What could go wrong with the tracheostomy? So I have four things listed here, and they are accidental decannulation, tube obstruction, bleeding from the tracheostomy, and cardiac arrest. Obviously, cardiac arrest is not an intrinsic problem with the tracheostomy, but it does pose some different considerations that you need to think about for your patient if they do go into cardiac arrest. The next question is, which of these is an emergency? The answer, of course, is all of them, although there are asterisks next to two. So a cardiac arrest is always an emergency. That one's pretty easy. Bleeding from the tracheostomy can be either minor or it can be serious, but one of the most serious complications of a tracheostomy is something called a fistula. So anytime your tracheostomy patient is bleeding, that needs to be evaluated and taken very seriously. The first two, accidental decannulation and tube obstruction, have stars next to them, and that's because these are not always emergencies. Sometimes it can be not that big a deal. And the reason for that is going back to this diagram again. So if your patient has had a laryngectomy and there's some problem with their tracheostomy, that means that they are no longer able to ventilate at all because their tracheostomy is their only source of ventilation. They can't ventilate through the mouth. On the other hand, if your patient does have a somewhat patent upper airway, if their tracheostomy has a problem, potentially that's not that big a deal. Potentially they're able to ventilate through the mouth, through their natural airway. So it's really important that you know whether or not your patient has two airways or one airway. In any case, some basic ideas about what you can do to manage your patient if a complication arises. The first thing is always to apply oxygen and assess the patient's oxygen saturations. Remember to apply oxygen to the appropriate airway. Again, if your patient has had a laryngectomy, their mouth is not continuous with their trachea, so you should not apply oxygen to the mouth. You should really only apply oxygen to the stoma. And then you want to see how your patient is doing. So are they desatting or not? Again, if your patient has a patent upper airway and you apply oxygen and their sats look fine, this isn't really an emergency. You don't need to take immediate action. You can kind of feel it out and see how things go. I have a few actions listed here for each of the potential problems, and I'm going to go through those really briefly. So if decannulation, if the tube falls out, you can attempt to replace the tube as long as the tracheostomy is mature, which is considered to be more than 7 days. A mature tracheostomy, the hole is going to remain open. There isn't a danger of the hole spontaneously closing very quickly or even in a few hours. So you can replace the tube if you feel comfortable, or you can contact someone who is better able to do it. If there's an obstruction, you want to assess the airway, assess the tracheostomy to attempt to find what the obstruction is. So you can look at the inner cannula. You can try passing a suction catheter, see if you can clear any obstruction by clearing the secretions. For bleeding, also you want to look for the source of the bleeding. If it's a minor bleed, you can attempt to stop that with pressure or with silver nitrate. One important thing to remember is if your patient is hemorrhaging, you want to try to prevent as much blood as passing into their lower airway, into their lungs as possible. One way you can do this is by inflating that cuff around the outer cannula, so that's going to prevent the flow of blood through the trachea. And then just a note, if your patient does go into cardiac arrest, you want to intubate through the stoma, not through the mouth. So, you know, what do I want you to remember from this presentation? I really, just kind of two facts is what you really need to know in order to keep your cool if your patient has a tracheostomy. So, know why your patient has a tracheostomy in the first place. Make sure you take a good history. And then second, you need to determine if your patient has a laryngectomy. Both of these pieces of information are going to guide your decision making in the case of any complications, and are going to allow you to make appropriate steps in determining whether or not the complication is an emergency. Thank you.